Audible Inc. presents Lady on the Hill, written by Howard E. Covington Jr. and the Biltmore Company, narrated by Mirron Willis.
Foreword by Lord Rothschild. Biltmore is an astonishing creation. A chateau set in rolling, wooded countryside with spectacular views of mountain ranges. It has its own vineyards and winery, elegant gardens, and is decorated and furnished with paintings and works of art that would not look out of place in museum collections in London, Paris, or New York. Yet Biltmore is not what it seems. It is not to be found in the Loire Valley in France, but rather in the southern Appalachian Mountains in the United States. Nor is it the product of centuries of aristocratic inheritance, but rather the vision of an extraordinary man, George Washington Vanderbilt. In building Biltmore, it was as if Vanderbilt, perhaps unconsciously, was paying homage to another astonishing creation across the Atlantic, the house with which it has been my privilege to be associated for more than 20 years, Waddesdon Manor in Buckinghamshire, England. Waddesdon is a Rothschild house, created, as Biltmore was, to provide a refuge and respite from city life for its owner, Baron Ferdinand de Rothschild, in 1874. Waddesdon was a place where he could enjoy the company of family and friends, and above all, provide a showcase for his collection of spectacular treasures: English 18th-century portraits, French 18th-century furniture and porcelain, carpets and textiles, often with royal provenance, paneling, sculpture, rare books and manuscripts, and what he called his Renaissance Museum, goldsmith's work, myolica, and enamels of the 16th and 17th centuries. Like Biltmore, Waddesdon was assembled with the pleasure principle firmly to the core. Guests were to be treated with every consideration for their comfort. Not one, but three kinds of tea were offered in the morning, along with two kinds of milk, in the most luxurious of surroundings. A weekend at Waddesdon would entail delicious food and wine, conversation and games, exploration of the estate and gardens, including the ornamental dairy, the huge range of glasshouses that grew fruit and flowers for the house, and Ferdinand's prized aviary of exotic birds, and, of course, a chance to enjoy the matchless collection of treasures. Like Biltmore, the house was constructed to a high technical specification with the early use of electricity and elevators and underfloor central heating fired by a furnace powered by its own gas station. Perhaps these parallels should not surprise us too much. After all, G.W. Vanderbilt was brought to Waddesdon in 1889 by his architect Richard Morris Hunt while on a tour of Europe looking for inspiration for their own project. Interestingly, both Hunt and Gabriel Hippolyte Detellier, Ferdinand's architect, chose the famous spiral staircase from the Chateau of Blois as focal points of their facades, and the great country houses built by the Rothschilds across Europe in the 19th century were already renowned. Yet the resonances do not cease with the architecture. The builders of both houses seem to have shared an innate reticence despite the magnificence of the surroundings. Just as G.W. Vanderbilt carried a passenger's luggage at Biltmore Station without demur when mistaken for a porter, Ferdinand enjoyed recounting how, at one of his famed baron's treats, when several hundred local children and their families were entertained with fun, games, and a splendid tea at the manor, he was told to get off the grass and don't smoke your pipe, it ain't allowed, by one of his guests. After the deaths of their founders, both houses were protected by powerful, charismatic women, in Biltmore's case, Edith Vanderbilt, G.W.'s wife, and in Waddesdon's, Miss Alice, Ferdinand's unmarried sister who inherited the estate and was fiercely protective of her brother's legacy. Alice did not face the prospect of opening Waddesdon to the public for the first time. That challenge fell to my cousin Dorothy, the widow of James D. Rothschild, who bequeathed the manor to the National Trust in 1957. That he did so was partly a tribute to his generosity, partly a response to Ferdinand's own fear expressed toward the end of his life that pictures and cabinets cross the Channel or the Atlantic, and the melancholy cry of the nightjar sound from the deserted towers, and partly a consequence of the realities of the post-World War II world for great country houses, even those owned by Rothschilds. Biltmore, of course, has stolen a march in this respect, opening to the public in 1930 before the establishment of the Biltmore Company, welcoming an impressive 39,913 visitors in that first year. Wadston's doors first opened in 1959, with 27,183 visitors. Not all of the years that followed were easy on either side of the Atlantic. At Biltmore, visitors' numbers fluctuated thanks to larger economic issues, like the oil crisis of the 1970s. The house and its treasures were greedy of resources, and the estate had to fight off threats from road building and a proposed new airport. At Wadston, the problem was almost too many visitors to a house that had not been designed to accommodate them. A timed ticket system had to be introduced to regulate the flow. The modern era at Biltmore could be said to have begun with the tenure of William Amherst Vanderbilt Cecil, who joined his elder brother George in managing the estate in 1963. It was his clear vision and determination that Biltmore's future should be secured through being profitable that made the company the success it is today. According to an old friend, William believed that when you live on a big estate, the first obligation is to preserve it. The second is to improve it. The third is to leave it in better shape than you found it. Those of us who know firsthand how difficult an equation this is to balance salute his achievement. By 1985, it was calculated that Biltmore contributed $350 million to the local economy in terms of employment and tourist revenue. This is the result of creative marketing, imaginative business strategies such as the opening of the winery in 1985, careful husbandry of resources, and huge investment. At Wadston, we are faced with a similar equation and a similar aim. The house, its surroundings, its contents, and what it stands for are uniquely precious. The centenary restoration, initiated by my cousin Dorothy, and carried out under my chairmanship of the management committee, succeeded in putting the manor from the roof to the cellars in good order for the future, and our drive is toward sustainability. Since we reopened after this fundamental overhaul, visitor numbers have risen to close to 300,000 a year. The huge costs of maintaining the property, the garden, and the curatorial and conservation needs of the spectacular collection are met by a family charitable trust devoted specifically to the upkeep of Wadston, the National Trust, visitor income, and the profits from a growing catering, retail, wine, and corporate entertaining business. Biltmore, as an outstanding example of commercial success, has been both a model for us and a major influence on our thinking. The future looks bright at Biltmore, now in the hands of a new generation of Cecils, William Amherst Vanderbilt Jr. And this book is a timely reminder of the efforts of the Vanderbilt family to secure it. Having watched Biltmore's developments over the recent years with great interest, I was honored to be asked to contribute to the foreword. And I hope that for Biltmore and everyone involved with this national treasure, the 21st century will be as impressive as the 20th has been. Chapter 1. A Centennial Celebration. The evening was clear and cool, and the pale hues of the late September sunset hinted at the glorious display of mountain color soon to arrive. William Amherst Vanderbilt Cecil had worried about the impending weather, since rain had prevailed for days before the centennial celebration at Biltmore Estate. To his delight, the clouds moved on, and this evening on the cusp of fall in 1995 was truly magical. As the concluding fireworks burst overhead, Cecil heard a child say she now knew how the stars are born. On this night, Cecil was surrounded by his extended Biltmore family, much as his grandfather, George Vanderbilt, had been on Christmas Day in 1895, the occasion marked as the official opening of his new home in North Carolina. It was then, as it was 100 years later, the largest private residence in the United States. Cecil had planned this celebration especially for current and retired Biltmore employees and their families. Some of them measured their length of service in decades, even generations, including one old hand who had been a driver for George Vanderbilt's wife, Edith. The Vanderbilts had annually welcomed those who worked and lived on their estate to a Christmas party, complete with presents all around. This gathering was considerably larger. The swarm of guests numbered more than 1,800. Following a dinner of Carolina barbecue on the South Terrace, all had settled into chairs on the front lawn for a concert by the Asheville Symphony Orchestra. Before the orchestra began its presentation of a selection of mostly 20th-century tunes, Cecil stepped to the front of a long stage. He was beaming with excitement and pride. Wearing a burgundy blazer familiar to his Biltmore family that he accented with a tie in a lively plaid, he was a hard man to miss. As he began, it was clear his purpose was sincere. "I only wish my grandparents could see all of you gathered here together," he said, "and see how many of us it takes to keep their dream a reality. I think they would be amazed." He spoke of the mystique of Biltmore, as well as the enduring connection between its people and the house and land. "It has been 35 years since I first came home to Asheville, and decided to rebuild what my grandfather had built with great determination in the late 1800s, Cecil said, in a voice that still carried evidence of his continental schooling. "I intended to do my utmost to bring back the dignity of Biltmore House, so she could once again be the grand lady on the hill. It has taken diligence, effort, ingenuity, and a strong, stubborn streak to bring her back to her glory. Today, in our centennial year, Biltmore Estate is, I believe, as my grandfather had envisioned her to be." The orchestra's finale of Tchaikovsky's 1812 overture, accented by the thunder of a cannon and the boom of the star-creating fireworks, rebounded off the front of the house, rattling the windows and stirring the soul. Finally, all made their way to their cars, accompanied by a tattoo from Scottish pipers. The following night, 400 guests, mostly family and friends from the United States and abroad, dined and danced at a party that spread throughout the first floor of the chateau. A midnight buffet was served in the banquet hall, and Biltmore wines flowed freely as Cecil's guests filled the grand rooms of the first floor, from the winter garden to the tapestry gallery, where a dance band was installed. Cecil and his wife Mimi circulated until the early hours, when the pipers returned for another salute. "By dawn," Cecil wrote a British friend unable to attend, "the Cinderella ball was over, and the daily shuffle of visitors was back to normal. No trace of anything out of the ordinary left." Biltmore Centennial was more than a birthday party. It was a celebration of the success of Cecil's extraordinary career. During his 35 years on the estate in Asheville, North Carolina, he had accomplished what everyone said could not be done. He had taken a down-at-the-heels Gilded Age mansion that was a drain on the family business and turned it into the most successful privately preserved historic site in the United States, perhaps the world. With creativity and an innate feel for promotion, reinforced by grit and determination, Cecil had seen to it that Biltmore Estate would remain for future generations to enjoy. The estate had become a travel destination with more visitors each year than Thomas Jefferson's Monticello, George Washington's Mount Vernon, and Elvis's Graceland. With more than 800,000 guests in 1995, it would soon surpass even Colonial Williamsburg in paid attendance. Such a record was never assured. On at least four occasions, before and after Cecil came home to tend to his patrimony, the distinctive chateau designed by Richard Morris Hunt could have ended on the auction block. Such an end would have drawn little more than a whimper from 20th-century preservationists whose tastes ran more toward patriotic venues, such as the home of Paul Revere, rather than the opulence of the Gilded Age. The fate for the exquisite landscaping of Frederick Law Olmsted could have been just as severe had the land been subdivided into building lots. In the 1950s, as Cecil pondered his own future, the directors of the family-owned Biltmore Company regarded the estate as little more than a real estate holding company. Partitioning the estate's 12,000 acres for residential housing or commercial development was a very real option. Instead, Cecil managed to preserve as well as restore the distinctive chateau and about 8,000 surrounding acres, Moreover, he had confounded the preservation world, as well as members of his own family, by accomplishing his mission without the support of government aid or grants from outside foundations. Cecil had realized a dream that even his grandfather had found elusive. He had made Biltmore Estate a self-supporting, working enterprise. This achievement was all the more remarkable since Vanderbilt was not bothered by the burden of modern-day taxation. In recent years, Cecil's Biltmore Company had paid more than $10 million annually in local, state, and federal fees and taxes. Under Cecil's hand, the estate had become one of Western North Carolina's most important economic engines. A 2004 study showed that it produced about $350 million a year in benefits to vendors, hotel owners, restaurant operators, shopkeepers, and others who served the tourist industry. At the time of the centennial, more than 700 people worked on the estate and in its various enterprises, including the vineyards and winery. A $20 million investment that Cecil had launched in the mid-1980s. He envisioned the winery carrying the company forward after the house tours eventually reached capacity. Cecil had followed his own rules in creating the modern Biltmore. There was no book, he often said. We wrote it. He took his lessons from Madison Avenue and people-pleasers like Walt Disney, not historical societies and Colonial Williamsburg. He promoted Biltmore as a tourist attraction and found his allies within the travel industry rather than academia. Every available dollar was invested in promotion. To make his money go further in the early days, he wrote his own advertising copy and took his own photographs, winning awards for his efforts along with lower ad rates. Even after he began delegating work to assistants, who were mostly talented young people he promoted from within, he was in and about the house daily, shooting photographs, tending to tourists, entertaining visiting journalists, arranging rooms, and making decisions. He was a polymath who came up with a week's worth of ideas before he finished his Monday morning shave. He gave his departmental managers budgets and expected them to make the numbers work. Those who didn't or couldn't found work elsewhere. Those who remained formed a bond with Cecil and with Biltmore. They get proprietary about it, said Cecil's wife, Mimi. They want to make sure it is okay and it is done right. Around here, we do things right. Cecil's flair for promotion earned Biltmore a reputation within the preservation community as being too commercial. His detractors complained that Biltmore's admission fees were too high and that visitors deserved more interpretation of the house, its contents, and the Gilded Age. They believed historic house museums should teach with docent-guided tours and signage explaining works of art or distinctive furnishings. Cecil did none of that. His guests wandered virtually at will among the rooms that were open for viewing. Biltmore runs contrary to what we all thought we ought to do, said a person who came out of the upper echelons of Colonial Williamsburg management. Many in the preservation community simply didn't believe that an owner of a historic property who was committed to making a profit could be serious about preservation. Since most attempts at private operation had turned into demonstrations of sleaze and profiteering, there was no place for a for-profit venture in the world of preservation. Some critics even discounted Cecil's winery, which he installed in the estate's abandoned dairy barn, saying the addition made the property even more of a theme park. In time, Biltmore's presentations of the house and the people who once lived there would exceed standards set by the American Association of Museums. The estate failed to qualify for membership because of its corporate structure, however. There was nothing cheap or tawdry about Biltmore. The estate didn't even have a gift shop until the late 1980s. The lady on the hill is a pretty good disciplinarian for you, Cecil often said. She sets a very high standard. Indeed, Cecil invested in Biltmore to his own detriment. One of his lawyers had discouraged him in 1980 from doing anything to the property since it only increased its annual tax bill. Yet, in the 15 years after he received that advice, the Biltmore Company invested $35 million in restoration, improvements, and annual maintenance. It was profits, Cecil would say later, that allowed him to hire his first curatorial professional. We don't preserve Biltmore to make a profit, he said. We make a profit to preserve Biltmore. He made no apology for Biltmore's admission price, which had been higher than every other comparable historic property. Cecil believed that Biltmore was unique, and visitors, rather than the government, should contribute to its survival. With the middle of the market crowded by so many mediocre venues, Cecil told his protégés that there was always room at the top. And what he was asking of tourists was honest, especially when he was paying taxes on a National Historic Landmark, a designation granted to the estate in 1963, and most of its government-owned or non-profit competitors were not. At Biltmore, Cecil said, we believe that the visitor should be the one to help pay for the preservation of the property. Such thinking usually left Cecil on the outside. Detractors didn't believe his numbers, or they discounted his efforts. When Biltmore was losing money in the early days, the company's red ink was evidence of what others considered Cecil's bootless exercise. After Biltmore began to produce a profit, he got no credit for his creativity and was told, well, that's Biltmore, as if success had been a foregone conclusion. From the day the chateau was first opened to the public in 1930, Biltmore was such an overwhelming experience that guests left believing they got their money's worth. Biltmore visitors experienced the Gilded Age and its lifestyle on a scale that defied common understanding. Plus, they were treated with such courtesy and hospitality that they left almost believing that George Vanderbilt himself had issued the invitation. Woe to the parking lot attendant found chewing gum, or to the guard with his hands stuffed in his pockets. Indeed, visitors came to Biltmore, and they kept coming back. By the 1990s, when the company began using sophisticated marketing measurements, the results of customer satisfaction reports by Biltmore visitors were comparable to those enjoyed by five-star resorts. For years, Cecil searched for relief from an ultimate accounting of inheritance taxes that could require the dismantling of it all when his heirs settled with the government. Unfortunately for him and his heirs, U.S. tax laws weren't written to accommodate the private owner who cared for a historic property, rather than leaving it to the government or sheltering it in some tax-exempt status, such as a foundation. Lawmakers in Raleigh and Washington discouraged Cecil's efforts to instill something similar to the British system that protected owners as long as they met certain standards and opened their homes to the public. Accommodating legislation to benefit a Vanderbilt was not the stuff of re-election. Cecil argued that private preservation not only worked, but was superior. He paid taxes and served the public good. Plus, he did it better. Bureaucrats and hired administrators brought unneeded burdens to the task and shared none of the incentive or passion for success held by a private owner. Cecil even founded the Historic House Association of America in an attempt to carry the fight for tax relief to Congress and export his message of private enterprise. Over the years, Cecil had enjoyed advantages not available to the owners of any other historic properties. He started with a structure that was fundamentally sound, although a bit run down. The foundation and infrastructure were as solid as when Vanderbilt had been in residence. Moreover, his grandfather's collection of art and furnishings was all in place. Thus, there was no need to recover family holdings that had been given away or sold over the years, a terrible expense and aggravation for others. Cecil had 50,000 pieces in the Biltmore collection from which to choose as he opened new rooms to the public. Most beneficial of all was Biltmore's location. When Vanderbilt created the estate in the late 19th century, Asheville was a remote resort town deep in Appalachia. The modern-day Biltmore sat at the intersection of interstate highways that had opened the western North Carolina mountains to millions of tourists from all compass points just when family travel was becoming most affordable. Cecil capitalized on it all, as well as inventions of his own, to return Biltmore to his glorious past. If George Vanderbilt himself had appeared in the banquet hall that Saturday night in September 1995, he would have felt right at home. Before the party for hundreds, he could have joined the Cecils and 64 special guests at a table laid to suit a wealthy scion. The menu for the sumptuous meal reflected the bounty of the estate. Tenderloin of Biltmore beef, Biltmore field greens, Carolina apple turnovers, and vintages from the winery, including champagne and claret. Beyond, the other rooms were aglow. The guide ropes were down, the utility mats were stored away, and fresh carpets covered the floors. A chair was for sitting, not for display. The house was to enjoy. Vanderbilt's favorite furnishings, his collection of books, Carl Bitter's sculpture, and the 16th-century tapestries remained where George Vanderbilt and his architect had placed them a century before. For this night, at least, Biltmore was not a historic house museum. It was a home. We were going to have a banquet. We were going to have a dance. We were going to open the house as it was in 1895, the way it would have been, Cecil told his house manager as preparations began for the celebration. The morning after the banquet, the magic of Biltmore was as vivid as ever, although early visitors saw no evidence of the Cinderella night that had just ended. That had all disappeared with the rising of the sun. The chateau, the gardens, and the winery were once again open for business. Chapter 2. George Vanderbilt's Dream. Asheville needed some good news in the early months of 1930. Winter had been hard on a city careful about keeping up appearances of prosperity and success. In October 1929, the release of Thomas Wolfe's Look Homeward, Angel had simply poleaxed Asheville, or Altamont, as Wolfe called it, with local personalities he held accountable in print. If such national ridicule wasn't enough, visiting businessmen, including the state's most respected banker, warned that the smoke from homes and factories that hung over the valley threatened Asheville's reputation as a tourist resort. Moreover, the economy was wobbly, and the tax coffers were empty. School teachers had already been laid off because there was not enough money to pay their salaries. The Asheville Citizen carried 8 full pages of legal notices listing real estate in jeopardy due to unpaid taxes. Then came news that was bound to lift the sagging tourist trade. The Asheville Chamber of Commerce announced that Cornelia Vanderbilt Cecil and her husband John had consented to admit the public to the magnificent mansion that her father had built on Biltmore Estate south of the city. On March 15, 1930, with a Pathé movie news camera capturing the occasion, the Cecils welcomed the first paying guests to their chateau. About 300 visitors from a dozen states turned out that first day. It was chilly, with guests squinting in the bright sunshine as dignitaries marked the event. Altogether, it was a fine beginning. Cornelia's welcoming remarks were carefully scripted, brief, and delivered on the steps just outside the front entrance. Unlike her gregarious mother, George Vanderbilt's widow, Edith, Cornelia wasn't keen on public appearances or her own celebrity. She shifted uncomfortably from foot to foot, but smiled generously nonetheless. John stood quietly by her side. She described Biltmore as a place that had given her much pleasure, never hinting that she would soon leave the estate and never return. She told the mayor, the chamber people, and the assorted officials gathered at the front steps that she was pleased to open the house as a gesture of goodwill to Asheville and as a memorial to her father. After all, she said, it was his life's work and his creation. That much was certainly true. Biltmore was the centerpiece of an estate that had once covered upward of 120,000 acres. No one ever quantified the total with any certainty, and had all but consumed her father, George Washington Vanderbilt. He had created a home of monumental proportions on a working estate the likes of which had never been seen in the United States. But Vanderbilt discovered there was a limit to his fortune. By the time of his death in 1914, he was struggling to retain the chateau and a relatively small amount of the vast estate that surrounded it. Even in the midst of his financial discomfort, George Vanderbilt probably would never have considered turning his home into a tourist attraction. Biltmore had been his retreat from social fussiness. One of the first things he did when he began assembling land for his new home was to buy out his neighbors. In later years, tourists were permitted to visit the grounds. Carriages crossed the narrow Swannanoa River that ran along the estate's northern boundary near Vanderbilt's nursery at Victoria, and carried visitors along the estate's landscaped roads where they could drink in the natural beauty of the countryside. On Wednesday and Saturday afternoons only, the owner's indulgence followed in the tradition of English nobility, who permitted the public to cruise the deer parks and forests of their country estates. The Biltmore excursions were carefully limited to the outlying roads, which included the first paved surfaces in western North Carolina. Carriages were forbidden to cross the esplanade when the family was in residence. Visitors only gained a view of the house if they were lucky. Perhaps with the help of a friendly member of the house staff, who was properly rewarded when the master was away, tourists might get a peek in the front door. This public opening was different, however. For the first time, visitors drove right to the chateau's massive front doors, parked their cars beside the esplanade, walked in, and presented their $2 tickets to guards outfitted in smart black serge uniforms bearing gold stripes and gold buttons, stamped with a V-paid admission, guaranteed a tour of a dozen rooms on the first and second floors. That was about 5% of the 250 rooms that architect Richard Morris Hunt had included in the mansion. Yet the tour more than satisfied guests who saw ceremonial hangings once owned by France's Cardinal Richelieu, 16th-century Flemish tapestries, a chess set that had belonged to Napoleon Bonaparte, a library of academic proportions, and art and sculpture from the greatest masters of Europe and America. There was even a rumor that one of the bathrooms contained a tub once used by the Caesars. This report was totally untrue, but survived as gospel for decades. Such was the allure of Biltmore. By the end of 1930, nearly 39,000 visitors had accepted the Cecils' invitation to see their home. Visitors also enjoyed breathtaking views of the mountain range that framed the house on the horizon and found a magnificence that defied imagination. The ordinary mortal, the tourist, the paying sightseer, is overcome by the sheer bigness of the entire estate, wrote M.V. Moore from Asheville's Patton Avenue. He goes his way, groping for words to describe the home and the absurdity of calling the Sphinx big, the Colorado Canyon pretty, the Biltmore House beautiful. It takes a master of words to even approach picturing this most beautiful home in America. It lifts from the land of every day into the land of make-believe. When the chateau opened for visitors, more than 40 years had passed since George Vanderbilt first visited Asheville in the winter of 1888. The Southern Highlands had long been a haven for Southerners escaping the summer heat. It all began with Charlestonians retreating to summer homes around Flat Rock, south of Asheville, near the South Carolina border. It was only after the opening of the railroad in 1880 that Asheville gained wider notice, especially among Northerners seeking a respite from the harsh New England winters. The new Battery Park Hotel near the center of Asheville still smelled of fresh-cut pine when George and his mother took rooms for an extended stay. George was 26, the youngest child of William H. Vanderbilt, who had inherited the bulk of the financial empire from his father, the great Commodore Cornelius Vanderbilt, who in his day had been the richest man in the United States. George was slender, of medium height, and darkly handsome with a thin mustache. His high forehead accentuated a narrow face, a deep chin, and deep-set eyes. His permanent address was the family mansion at 640 Fifth Avenue in New York City, but he had traveled widely abroad, collecting art and treasures that suited his fancy. On one trip to Japan, he returned with 20 cases of carved ivory. He had recently acquired a home in Bar Harbor, Maine, where the noted landscape designer Frederick Law Olmsted was reshaping 30 acres of grounds. Unlike many of his age and station, George was not consumed with the social swirl of the Gilded Age. He preferred outings on his yacht, the Lucille, and the relatively informal Bar Harbor compared to the ostentation of his tribe's favorite haunt, Newport, Rhode Island. He was quiet, studious, and, of course, rich beyond the imagination of most Americans. Although he was not as well endowed as some of his seven brothers and sisters, his inherited fortune was in the neighborhood of $13 million. He had been tutored at home before he enrolled at 16 in what later became Columbia University, where he graduated with high honors. A personal library filled the walls of his suite at 640 Fifth Avenue and contained volumes in 8 languages, in which George was fluent enough to converse virtually anywhere in the modern world, much of which he had seen by the time he turned 21. George filled his life with art and philosophy rather than finance. His name was noticeably absent from the directory of directors, an inventory of those running U.S. businesses. He was especially fond of architecture and passionate about opera. When the Metropolitan Opera was performing in New York, he attended 4 or 5 nights in a row. The trip south in 1888 was both an adventure and in aid of his mother, who suffered from chronic malaria. Asheville's climate and altitude were reputed to be a healing environment for a number of ailments. The place suited her, as it did George, who was said to be haunted by the fear of tuberculosis. While his mother came under the care of Asheville's Dr. S. Westry Battle, a prominent physician with a cultured clientele, George often rode on horseback to explore the countryside. He was especially taken with the long vistas that carried his eye to the mountain peaks on the horizon. One of the most prominent was Mount Pisgah, whose summit at more than 5,000 feet capped the far ridge line about 20 miles away to the southwest. On a return visit in the late spring of 1888, Vanderbilt was accompanied by his friend and attorney, Charles McNamee. When the two found a particularly enjoyable spot about 6 miles south of Asheville, the end of a small ridge offered such a commanding view of Pisgah that Vanderbilt and McNamee rode directly to the landowner's house and purchased it along with 10 acres of land. McNamee moved quickly to buy the surrounding land to cleanse the landscape of unsightly cabins that were the homes of subsistence farmers happy to exchange their meager holdings for cash. Within the year, McNamee had accumulated several thousand acres for Vanderbilt. Additional land was added, including the farm and shack of one stubborn neighbor, who reportedly held out for $75,000 on property said to be worth no more than $200. In short order, George's vision for a comfortable country home grew beyond that of most of his siblings, who were known for their huge, elaborate mansions in Newport. Vanderbilt founded Biltmore, a name that drew upon his family's ancestral home in Bilt, Holland, with a purpose far grander than pure seasonable pleasure. With an inherited fortune produced from a railroad empire fat with profits of the Industrial Revolution, George set out to build an estate based on an old-world agrarian model of manor house and tenant farms with an accompanying village, parish church, and school. The house would be handsome, to be sure, but more importantly, it was the focus of a larger investment that would be capable of producing an income and sustaining itself for years to come. Plans called for herds of sheep, a swine farm, and a poultry operation with the usual chickens, as well as Mongolian and English pheasants to be released onto the land. One of the first enterprises was a nursery to supply plants for the landscaping of the estate, and eventually to meet a market of gardeners around the country. There was talk of a 500-acre truck farm to produce food for the house as well as for sale in local markets. Biltmore would become known for many things, but two of the young man's early investments marked it more than others did. First was the dairy farm that Vanderbilt stocked with a herd of more than 200 purebred Jerseys from the family farm in Long Island, New York. Second was the establishment of the first managed forests that were developed under Olmsted's plan by Vanderbilt's friend Gifford Pinchot. Work began in 1889 on the house designed by Richard Morris Hunt, who had traveled widely in Europe with Vanderbilt, gathering ideas and making plans. As work commenced, hundreds of laborers and craftsmen in stone and wood were drawn to jobs that offered steady wages. Vanderbilt quickly became the largest employer in western North Carolina. The volume of building materials was such that a 3-mile railroad spur costing nearly $80,000 was laid to the house from the main line that ran beside the Swannanoa River. Over the next 5 years, the limestone mansion rose slowly on a site that offered a prospect of the French Broad River and the mountains beyond. For his design, Hunt borrowed from the style of the French Renaissance Chateau of the Loire Valley, especially the Chateau de Blois. Even aside from its sheer size, Hunt's creation was unlike any other in the United States. Asked to compare Biltmore with his other accomplishments, he would say, "They are but pigsties in comparison. Nothing but pigsties." Olmsted called Biltmore the most distinguished private place, not only in America, but of the world, forming in this period. Soaring spires and gargoyles marked the exterior of the mansion front, whose impressive silhouette was matched only by that of the distant mountains. Inside, Hunt provided for every modern convenience. Despite its hundreds of rooms, the space enjoyed an easy and logical flow. In addition, the building was fully wired for electricity. Elevators carried guests and staff between floors, and 3 steamship boilers produced heat centrally that was carried to every room. In the summer, cool air rose through a series of airways that used the chimneys for draft. Although Vanderbilt himself could not swim, an indoor pool was provided for the pleasure of his guests, as was a bowling alley and a gymnasium. Hunt built the house on a landscape sculpted by Olmsted. His Biltmore commission was the largest and the last of his career. His influence was profound. Olmsted sited the house, then set about designing a winding road about 3 miles long that turned arrival at the mansion gates into a breathtaking event. The farms, the forests, and of course the gardens all felt his touch. His masterpiece was to be a 9-mile arboretum drive along which he planned to showcase varieties of trees, shrubs, and woody plants in much the same way that Hunt's mansion presented Vanderbilt's collection of art. 100 years later, Hunt's mansion would leave visitors in awe, but it was Olmsted's creative genius in the use and rehabilitation of the land that would set the estate apart. The designer himself called it the first great private work of our profession in the country. Indeed, Vanderbilt filled his house with treasures from abroad. Carpets, paintings, sculpture, and furnishings of all manner and size arrived at the railway station in the village that Vanderbilt constructed just outside the lodge gate. Finally, impatient after 5 years of work, Vanderbilt refused to wait for the finishing of his chateau and simply moved in. He officially occupied the house in October 1895, taking up residence and completed portions of the north wing, while work continued on the main rooms on the first floor. In December, with nearly 30 members of his immediate family as his guests, he celebrated Christmas in his new chateau. Presents were handed all around to family and staff alike from under a fir tree that stood 40 feet tall in the banquet hall. At the time, he was 33 years old. Among the treasures Vanderbilt found abroad was a mistress for the manor. In 1898, 2 years after his mother's death, he married Edith Stuyvesant Dresser of New York, to whom he had given considerable attention the year before in London at the Jubilee celebration for Queen Victoria. The June marriage stunned New York society. George was thought to be a confirmed bachelor after none of the repeated rumors of earlier engagements had proved to be true. The couple honeymooned in Spain, then spent the balance of the summer in Italy. In October, George and Edith returned to Biltmore, where they were welcomed by a huge floral horseshoe with the words "Good Luck" spelled out with blossoms of goldenrod. Nursery workers tossed flowers to the bride as the carriage passed by. That night, there were fireworks. Construction at the estate seemed to have no end. Barns and estate buildings, houses for farm workers, and a large creamery were added to the working side of the farm. At the same time, work continued on the model village outside the lodge gate that included the Hunt-designed All Souls Church, consecrated in 1896, a 2-story office building, a rail depot, and more than 2 dozen trim and neat cottages. Then it all stopped abruptly, with entire rooms in the mansion unfinished. A scientific museum that Olmsted had planned as the centerpiece of his arboretum remained on the drawing board. Some speculated that Vanderbilt was simply exhausted with the constant interruptions of workmen and architects, more troublesome now since the arrival of Cornelia, the Vanderbilt's daughter, who was born in the house on August 23, 1900. It was also said that Vanderbilt refused, or was simply unable, to pour more cash into the estate that had consumed perhaps as much as half of his entire fortune. There seemed to be no logic in the unfinished work. The front row of organ pipes was installed in the loft of the banquet hall, but the others were dummies, and there was no organ. A large room just off the entrance hall that Hunt had designed as a music room was left with a bare subfloor, brick walls, and a rough, unfinished ceramic tile ceiling. An adjacent room, particularly suited for afternoon tea, was left in the same condition, even though it offered a fabulous vista of the mountains. Edith made do with rudimentary decorations. She draped a woolen fabric in billows from the ceiling and cast assorted cushions about the carpets that covered the rough concrete floor. For years, it was called the tent room. Vanderbilt's deteriorating financial situation clearly was a consideration. For some time, he had ignored warnings from advisors who told him that his architects and builders were spending more than his bank account could afford. In fact, cash flowed in so many directions that a final cost of the house became virtually impossible to calculate. A grand total remained buried in boxes of bills and receipts that no one ever tallied to the penny. Losses on other investments also may have forced him into retreat. He began scaling back at Biltmore and reduced his annual maintenance at the estate from $250,000, the cost in the early years, to about $70,000. By 1906, he had closed the poultry operations and announced plans to lease out his forest land as a hunting preserve. George was helped by the sale of a portion of his art collection, and he leased the Fifth Avenue mansion he inherited upon his mother's death to financier Henry Clay Frick. Things remained dark, however. In 1907, he sent word to put virtually all of his North Carolina property on the market, saving only 1,000 acres around the chateau. A year later, he and Edith closed the house entirely. The servants were dismissed. The pleasure horses were sold, and the family sailed for Europe where they could live comfortably on less money. Budget cuts continued into 1909 when Vanderbilt notified Dr. Carl A. Skink that he would no longer underwrite the operation of the Biltmore Forestry School, the nation's first, that Skink had launched in 1898. Skink left in a huff due to a dispute over a hunting lease he had authorized and sued for back wages. During his years at Biltmore, Skink had created something on Vanderbilt land that had never been attempted before in the United States, a managed forest plantation where harvests did not exceed the annual growth. Heretofore, American loggers had simply stripped the land of trees and left the denuded acres to restore themselves. Some of Vanderbilt's property was in this condition when he acquired it, but the vast tract also included large stands of virgin timber. Skink introduced European forestry techniques that in time demonstrated that a managed forest not only produced more timber, but also conserved the soil and improved the total environment. The men at Skink's school were not just students, but disciples, who wrote songs about the tough, demanding German whose large, bushy handlebar mustache earned him the nickname of the Kaiser. Aboard his large bay mare named Punch, Skink led them into the depths of Pisgah Forest, where they set up camp and lived for weeks at a time. After Vanderbilt ended his underwriting of his school, Skink relocated and produced 4 more classes before leaving the United States in 1913 for Germany and service in World War I. With the New York newspapers watching the Vanderbilts' every move, the news reports of George and his estate provided a significant bump for Asheville, an otherwise sleepy mountain resort. Likewise, changes on the estate always sent a tremble through the countryside. Rumors in 1898 that Vanderbilt was forsaking North Carolina had proved false, but carried enough credibility that the town had organized a chamber of commerce to rebut the widespread press accounts. The estate, as it was called locally, remained the area's best employer and its richest source of local tax revenue. When Vanderbilt was late in 1909 with payment of his property taxes, local school teachers didn't get their pay. Even in hard times, North Carolina was never far from Vanderbilt's mind. He named his private rail car the Swannanoa. Cornelia's nickname was Tar Heel Nell. Even after he curtailed expenses, he remained devoted to Biltmore. The family continued to live in the chateau about 6 months out of the year, even longer in 1905, when George took personal charge of operations on the estate. He spent hours walking in the mountains and pursuing an intense study of the trees, flowers, and natural beauty he found there. A frequent companion was Chauncey D. Beadle, a Canadian who had come south to work for Olmsted and stayed on to complete his plans after the great designer became incapacitated and later died. Olmsted's restored forests and the lush gardens near the chateau were a delight, but it was said that Buck Spring Lodge, high on Mount Pisgah, was the most appealing spot of all. The lodge was an expansive Adirondack-style complex of 4 buildings made primarily of chestnut logs, some of them 40 feet in length. The main building, whose porch was 60 feet across, had a central hall with 5,000 square feet of floor space. This building was connected by a breezeway to adjacent sleeping rooms for guests and on to a kitchen and a dining hall. Hunt began designs for the lodge before he died, but it wasn't finished until 1902 under the direction of his son, Richard Howland Hunt. The lodge sat just under Pisgah's summit in the saddle of a ridge off to the southwest. The site was nearly 20 miles from the chateau and almost as deep into the mountains as Vanderbilt could go. Access initially was only on horseback, but an early trail was widened and improved, and the contorted route with frequent switchbacks became a showpiece of mountain road construction. From this area, at roughly 5,000 feet above sea level, the air was easily 10 to 20 degrees cooler than at the chateau. Guests enjoyed an unparalleled view of deep, green forests with only the breeze and the birds to disturb the quiet. In the early summer, a lush valley just below was transformed into a field of color. The profusion of rhododendron, laurel, and native azaleas earned it the name the Pink Beds. Vanderbilt spent one entire summer at Buck Spring, coming down only for a haircut at the village of Candler. Vanderbilt's retreats to Buck Spring.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.